So currently we are contemplating the talks from day 11, 12, 13, and 14, which are all related to Jagat Utpatti. So in that, what we have done right now is, instead of our earlier approach of day-wise talk related contemplation, we now are using the topic-wise talks. The same day-wise talk has been divided into topics, and short videos are there. And Saravananji has made extensive notes from each of those topics, and that is what we are these days using as a reference material. So we have right now contemplated till talk 54. Can Saravananji quickly summarize from 50 to 54? That way we can move on to the next topic today.
Okay. So, yeah, 51 is where we the starting of chapter 3, Jagat. So till 50 we covered Atma Tattva Viveka, and from 51 we are moving into the Jagat. So there, before we start getting into how to understand Jagat, the talk starts with like, what are the ways to get new knowledge? How get new knowledge? And that's where we saw that the direct and the indirect ways. Indirect being either paroksha, which is a belief, someone tells and like you go with the belief, or anumana, you infer from the past experience, or pratyaksha, from what the sense organs give us. And we have seen that like all the three have their own limitations, while the direct is the one which doesn't require anything outside, and seems to be the most clearest, being aproksha, and what we call it aproksha anubhuti, right? And it's the way aproksha is explained is with the example of the question to the answer, who am I in a dark room, right? When somebody asks you, when you're in a dark room, who like, are you there? And the answer to that comes right away, and you don't need your sense organs to tell you, or you don't infer and say, or you don't believe it. It is self-luminous, right? And so now that's the highest way of understanding and knowing something. Directly, because the moment we have a medium in between, we are limited. That what we learn or know is limited by the limitations of that instrument, either the sense organs or the prior knowledge or the belief system, right? So that's with T51. And yeah, in T52 we continue on that. And while the main thing what we explored is, as the way we end is now the
okay, looks like Saravananji's internet got cut.
So we have moved from how to know.
Saravananji?
I think looks like my internet is.
Yeah. There's a problem.
Not stable.
We were not able to hear you when you started saying in T52 we continue, and that's when you got cut off.
Okay. So let me start on the T52, right? So in the T52, we continue on the ways of knowing, and we explore into are you there question, right? And the answer comes right away as it is self-luminous, and then we look into like how did you answer, right? And the reason why I said is like I can feel myself is that because of that awareness, right? And and from the previous chapter we have seen that we are not the body which we can see, the object, the mind which we can always feel the thoughts, right? And the intellect, rather it's the awareness, what we refer to as Atman. And why is, if that knowledge is clear, are we am I able to be that way all the time is the question, right? Because if that understanding is clear, that knowledge should lead us to liberation. And if that is not clear, there is an error in the understanding, right? And the prescription given for that error correction, that which is the bondage to the body, is the three paths: the Karma Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, and Jnana Yoga. Right. So the amount of knowledge that leads us towards the wrong understanding, the bondage to the body, that needs to be removed. And these three yogas help us to clear them, so that like we go back to the understanding, and like we are clear with, we are able to live by the understanding as well, right? So that's where we end at T52. Are you able to follow me? Is the connection good still?
Yeah.
Okay. So now we moved on to T53. So we talked about the body, right? Now we said like, so I can see the body and whatever outside my body. So we wanted to look into that. What is that? What is that world, Jagat? Right. So what we saw is like the world appears and disappears. Why does it appear and disappear? As we see that in the waking state, we see the world. In the dream, we don't see this world. Some other world appears. This world disappears and some other world appears. And in the deep sleep, even the dream world has disappeared. Right? And like when we again wake up, this world again appears. Right? So how do we learn about this? Right. So should we go by again the methods? We are looking into the methods, right? As we see, the most effective way will be the direct, the self experience. Right. All the other methods again will try to, like the science will say that there was a big bang. And they will go into the research-based explanation, right? Or the Puranas will say Devas created the world like so and so. So what is the best way to understand this Jagat, the world in which what we see outside our body, right? So that's where we move into T54, where the explanation starts, where we say that Brahman alone is real and the world has come from Brahman. And when we say that, we start seeing the opposites. Right? What we learn about Brahman is unchanging, eternal consciousness, pure consciousness, and infinite. While the world is completely the opposite. It is changing all the time. And the world is full of matter. And it's finite. We see it's finite. So if the world is from Brahman, why is it completely looking the other way? Right? So there is a gap. Anything that comes from the source should have the same properties or characteristics. Right? And here it seems to be completely different. That's where the concept of Maya comes in between. Right? So the Brahman, from Brahman, Maya comes, which is what creates the world, we see. Right? And like the way Maya is introduced is like, Maya, like there are two words, avarana shakti, and so it Maya hides what is the real one, and at the same time it shows what is not there. There are two properties of Maya, right? So we'll go into those in the later ones, and and there is a discussion on how this we talk about in Advaita. We say that Brahman alone is real. Brahman is the only one. And how did this world come? How did Brahman create? And taking this potter example, right? There is a base material the potter uses, which is the clay. And then the intelligence, the potter, to create the pot, the outcome, right? And same way, the gold jewelry is made from gold by the jeweler and on the ornament. And in this case, there is Brahman, right? And there is world. What did he use? Right? So here they give the story. They show how a spider spins its web. Right, the spider uses its own saliva to create the web. It doesn't use anything outside of it. Right, so the same way, when Brahman creates the world, Brahman is not using something outside of Brahman to create the world. Right, and that's where the Maya is used. Using Maya, the Brahman creates the world. So in this case, the technical terms being used, the Nimitta Karana and Upadana Karana. Nimitta Karana being the intelligence cause and Upadana Karana being the material. And so in this case, Brahman is both Nimitta and Upadana Karana for the world. The way how a spider uses its own saliva to spin the web. Right? That's where we have stopped right now.
So if we consider the key question, see, there are three entities. There is Jiva, there is Jagat, there is Ishvara.
Jagat.
Jiva is who I think I am. So there is this body and this mind. This is who I am. And I am operating in the world. And there are so many things in the world. And the world is infinite. And of course, I also feel I didn't create all this mountain, air, water, whatever, so many things. So it is created by somebody else. So I arrive at, there is a higher intelligence. So there is Jiva, there is Jagat, and there is a higher intelligence. And I've given the name Ishvara. So in our journey so far, till the Jagat Utpatti, what we have seen is how this, whatever I think I am as a body and a mind is incorrect, is a asatya, is a anitya. This much has been very clearly established. I am not this body and I'm not this mind. very clearly established. Then what is my nature? My nature is that of Sat and Chit, and it is bliss. This much also has been clearly established. Now,
yes,
is where I still have the world to deal with. And the world also has properties. And I still have to see, yes, what is my connection to Ishvara and the world. So that is where the Jagat Utpatti is again taking us step by step into the process of Jagat Utpatti. And then we have to see what is the connection among all these. So the fundamental journey is to reconcile our inner understanding between Jiva, Jagat and Ishvara. So we are in that journey now. So therefore we are now looking into Jagat Utpatti. So far we have seen ourselves, who I am, and now about the world. Anything else that Padmaji, Shubhaji wants to add? All right, excellent. So then, you know, we can jump into T55 talk. But before we jump there, is Priyaji and Satyaji so far been able to go through these videos?
Once I have gone through, Vijayji, understood the concept.
Okay. Is there anything you would like to add till whatever has been summarized by Saravananji?
Same.
Excellent. Okay.
One thing I was kind of thinking, like when we consider into individual part, right, individual Jiva, so the text directly tries to differentiate between Jiva and Jagat. So, and Jiva and another Jiva, there is how to feel that contemplation.
Let's come in T55.
Okay.
What is your question? Can you put the question clearly?
No, Jiva and Jagat, like Jagat Utpatti and all, we will be contemplating, no? Like one individual Jivas, like Jivatma.
Hmm.
So how I feel and how you feel, mutual this thing.
Now, what is the question?
That is the same thing. So that is only itself is the question. Might be, yeah. I'll not be that clear.
How do I interpret the other Jiva?
Hmm.
Jiva and Jagat, we are trying to understand. How about Jiva and Jiva?
Jiva and Jiva.
Another Jiva is part of Jagat. So at the end of the day, everything else has been put as Jagat. In my conscious experience, there is Priyaji, Padmaji, Saranunji, Shubhaji, the tree, the wind, the house, the computer, all of this is in my experience right now. All of this is what I'm interpreting as Jagat. In that Jagat, some are animate. Some can ask questions, some can smile, some are pleasant, some are, they don't have any kind of reaction. They seem to be always standing there. Some team seem to be swaying. So there are all different levels of Jivas, but at the end of the day, they all, as far as I am concerned, all are Jagat.
Hmm.
So
okay.
Jagat. So once when I realize what is my connection to the Jagat, then other Jivas are also part of the Jagat. So in a way, in one sense to say, what is Jagat? Jagat is nothing but sum total of other Jivas.
Mm.
All the others are also Jivas in one sense.
Mm.
At different levels.
Mm.
Water also seem to have its own intelligence. A flower seem to have its own intelligence. Air has its own intelligence. Animal has its own intelligence. The person has his own intelligence. Even a stone seems to have intelligence, but at a very low level. So everything has a varying levels of the quality that I use to identify a jiva is nothing but, oh, okay, it seems to be talking. But is that the only thing? No, you know, it seems to show life. And by life, we mean that, you know, the ability to grow. Even mountains grow. Even stones seem so strong to change, maybe over a period of long time. But in a way, everything is a jiva in that way. So jagat is nothing but sum total of the jivas. Is that a way to look at?
Yes, it is. I understand.
Yeah. So that is why we are looking at what is the jagat utpatti. So the journey is, I am not this body and I am not this mind. That is clearly established. Now, what is my connection to the world? Because these are the only two fundamental questions. Who am I? And what is this world and what is my connection to the world? Once when who am I is clear, then if the world is clear, then the totality is clear.
Then another way I would like to put is like the two sorry. Things are.
There seems to be background noise in your place. Yeah.
Yeah. The two things we can put it under are awareness and the objects. Right. So in the awareness, all are appearing, including my own body, mind, intellect is appearing as an object, and all other jivas and the world, what we call the world jagat, is a collection of objects, and there is awareness. Right. So the other jiva, if you're talking about, again, that person is awareness in, is an object in my awareness.
Is an object in my awareness. Correct. So ultimately, to Priyaji, Saranamji is the sounds that you heard just now and the sight you are seeing just now. As far as Priyaji's awareness is concerned, Priyaji looks at the world as, oh, I can see Saranamji's face, I can see I can hear Saranamji's voice. So when he says object, that's what he means. It's an object in your mind. It's an object appearing in your screen called mind. And that is how you say, yeah, I know Saranamji. Whereas another object, a tree, may not make spoken sounds. It will make some other sound, some other movements. So you are aware of that. A stone will not even say anything. It is just there. Like the koan, the Zen story. The story says something, you know, it's up to you to now interpret. The stone is saying something, it's up to you to now realize.
Yeah, and our sense organs we have seen that our sense organs have limitations. So they are tuned to listen or like hear from another similar being, but not necessarily a different being like a bird or a plant or a stone. Maybe they are using different ways which our sense organs are not tuned to, right, due to the limitations.
Actually, our sense organs are not limited in that sense of perception. But because of the concepts in the mind, it seems to be limited. I saw the other day one wonderful video. There's a person in, maybe after the session I will share that. He speaks the crow language, and whenever he speaks, the crows come. Okay, the way he is explaining about the crow language is fascinating. You're saying that there are different types of sounds based on which, you know, how they communicate. See, they need to communicate where I am and what is available. So it's like calling, no? And my guru once said, when somebody in life, no, is very for me, they have to take the life of a crow and invite others and share. Because if you see what is the nature of a crow, it invites others. Even the smallest thing, it invites others. So then only they realize that lesson, that it is important to share and care and to move in life. But anyway, that's beside the main thing. Point is, he is able to speak and he demonstrates that. It's fascinating to see that in that video, he starts making some sounds, and suddenly you will see all around that building, no? Some 30, 40 different crows come and sit. I'll share that video.
Yeah, I think, yeah, maybe I should modify my answer as the body as we understand. I don't think the body will have a lot more powers which are not easily understood by everyone. There are some hidden powers which once you unlock, then maybe, as you said.
No, they're actually your powers expressed through the body.
Okay.
You as awareness, when you're not limited, you have... It's like a small baby. It can learn French, Tamil, English, Malayalam, or 20 languages very easily. How? There is no limitation that, I am a Kannadiga, so I will speak only Kannada.
Yeah. The baby is not tuned to any language. It's open to any language.
It is designed to mimic.
Mm.
So it can mimic anything.
Mm. Yeah, that means, you can extend that to a crow and other things.
Not only that, maybe it's a small aside. Is it okay if I show one small video?
Yeah.
Okay. There is this...
Yeah.
That's our infinite capacity.
Agree.
It gets limited by the training of the world.
So we can say that body is a medium of expression, and you should not say that it's a limitation of the body.
Yeah. See, the cells, they don't really have a feeling of hatred to another cell. When you hurt here, what is the natural thing? This goes here and then says, it tries to give some care, no? Here it says, this is part of me. Even the other one, it is like that only. Just that the mind says, okay, that is another body. Not my problem. But these cells have no such feeling. There is no sense of hate in the cells. It's what is generated in the mind. Then the cells become a little confused. Yeah.
I believe what we think, even if we don't say, it goes out as vibrations. So a fear in me can actually go out even without me actually expressing it. And the other animal or whatever, they can sense it. Okay, this person is not feeling comfortable with me. That means there is some thing. The person sees me as a different, right? So Yeah.
So have you seen little children take some baby animals, maybe cat or something, by the neck and carry? And the cat is just sitting there. Whereas, you know, if a little grown up tries to catch it, it maybe either runs away or then growls.
Yeah.
The vibration level has changed because animals don't see you as another body. You know, they sense the vibrations.
Yeah. Dogs. I've seen that with dogs. Until you get comfortable, like they don't leave. It's a apt video for T55 topic.
Yeah. Saranji, are you there?
Yes, I'm there.
Okay. Yeah. So please continue. Please continue your summarization.
Should I, or before we get, if I have anything to comment,
or does anyone else have anything else to comment? Okay, Shubhaji or Priyaji, is there anything else?
No sir.
Okay.
No, Vijayji, from the video, it's clear that like the vibration or the frequency, what we are talking, I think the way sometimes one person likes the other or dislikes the other, whatever. So there the frequency matches or the feelings, because see, sometimes a few people will be near to us since many years. We don't like them or they don't like us. But one other, sometimes they are very far and we need we will share everything. So I think that is the thing what you told, the vibrations or the frequency. Like one person getting more into the other person, that is how it works, and the bondage and builds between two individuals.
And at a more fundamental level, I like something, I don't like something. I have a more affinity towards one person, not affinity towards another person. Is still, there are certain blocks in the mind about likes and dislike. And that little child is able to so easily be with all the animals, because in that little baby, there is no sense of fear. There is no sense of separation. There is no judgment about a cruel, ugly, good, nice. So it just is, in the most innocent way. And that innocence is the natural vibration. In that state of innocence, that's why, do you see little babies, if you look around them, they're glowing. You know, if you talk in terms of aura, right, in terms of aura, energy field, little children, you see them, they're just glowing. How? Because nothing to stop that glowing. That is your inherent nature. That is your true nature. Like Padmaji's story said, at the end, the master had a wonderful smile. How that smile comes? A smile can happen only when there is no
blocking.
Smile. You know, a true smile, you can make out anybody's face. You don't need training for that. You know it, whether somebody is smiling courteously or, is it appearance? How? Because you already are, that is your nature, that is given to you. Given is also incorrect. Given means something that was given to you. It is there. So the whole process of spiritual evolution is getting rid of this conditioning in the mind and to go back to that original status. Thank you.
I think it's another way is going back to the means of knowing. The aparoksha gives the truest or like purest form of the knowledge, right? So even when we are not uncomfortable, don't like, it is from one of the other three ways. Either somebody says that he is harmful, so right, or from or you use anumana. One of these people has done some harm, so you try to infer, right? But what this video also showed is when you remove all those other means and like be your true self, right? The direct experience is what you are seeing, aparoksha. Okay.
With a small baby, all of us are very comfortable. You naturally light up, you naturally lighten, you naturally smile. Because there is nothing in your mind which is causing a disturbance. Whereas, let's say, for example, you know, you go to some very intelligent fellow, you know, who is a PhD in some subject. You're already having a lot of apprehensions in the mind. Ayo, should I speak or not? You know, how will I be judged? Have you noticed that? Among our so-called very intelligent and brainy friends, how do you feel versus, you know, when you're with a little baby or with a plant? Have you noticed the difference? Is it audible? Okay. Well, let's continue. So Saranji, please summarize your understanding of T55.
Sorry, I've been having some issues with the Bluetooth, so I moved to another one.
Okay.
You're waiting for me?
Yeah, I was asking, can you summarize? I think now, till T54, the discussion is clear.
Mm-hmm.
There are no questions or statements coming. So can we now go into T55?
Yeah, so T55, yeah, sure. So T55, the topic starts with a flower. Right. So when we see a flower, what happens? Right. So for us, it's an object. Right. I'm perceiving it as an object. And how? And immediately I say that, let's say it's a rose. Right. How did we say that it's a rose? And it's from, if you use our ways of knowing, have used past knowledge somewhere, like where I've been told that this color, this form is labeled as a rose. While if you go beyond this name, it is just an object which has a shape and has a color. Right. So when I see that, how I am basically inferring it based on my past. Now, that experience is what I said as a subjective experience of the seer. Right? You can expand this to any object or any being, and when you see it, it's everything is a pure form, right? But the moment you see it, using the past memory or inference, it creates an experience in the seer, right? That's where, as Vijayji was saying, like likes and dislikes come. And it is purely based on the inference, I would say.
right? Because the way with the past experience, you start liking something, you start disliking something. And the way you've been learning, saying this is nice, this is good, this is not good, right? That is what the actually creates the experience in each and everyone. Now, what about, is that the true thing, right? If you inspect to yourself, we cannot say that. In the sense, I cannot say that what I see is the real one with 100% confidence, right? So it is what has been projected by my sense organs, interpreted by mind, right? Or projected by my mind, which is what I am coming to know about. Is that really the case? Right? It's not easy, because if the way to see it is in my awareness, these objects are being projected, and what is being projected is what I am seeing or interpreting. Truly, what is there outside, can I say, is the question now. Right? If you take this the video example as well, right? The same animal can be creating different experiences to different people. For that caregiver, the animal looked very, very natural. At the same time, if for another person, it can create fear, right? Did the animal create the fear? No, right? It is basically what you yourself have interpreted it that way or inferred it that way, right? So what the talk is going into is finally that what is real and what is unreal, we should be able to separate it. The way we infer seems to be a layer on top of it, on top of the real thing. And the real thing is existence. There is something existing, I can say for sure. There is an object existing, right? And the object is that existence is real, and the awareness that is seeing it is real, and right there we stop. Right? Anything beyond these two, existence and awareness, is what creating all this raga dvesha. Right? So, and that if you go back to what you've been learning, that existence, awareness are the qualities of Atman or Brahman. Right? So which then we can say that everything that exists, right? The Brahman alone is existing in different forms, names, forms, and like we are basically giving names to each of those existence, right? And the Brahman did not create any of those experiences. It is the seer who is creating that experience of like what it is. But in the purest form, the Brahman is manifested as a tree or a flower or another jiva, all this, right? So that's so that is one part of the video, and the second part of it is, so we say that like Brahman alone is manifesting in different ways, right? So can I say that this plant, animal, being, all are Brahman, right? If Brahman is all of these, but the opposite is not the right way, which basically will limit the Brahman. Okay, you cannot say that Brahman alone, Brahman is just this. You cannot limit it, right? Yes, everything is Brahman, but Brahman is not that thing alone, right? It's it's much, it's a universal consciousness, you can say. Right? So that's where we will be end this talk, T55.
Very nice.
Yeah.
So before we go into questions, so let's hear from others also. Who wants to go next? Padmaji, Shubhaji, and Priyaji.
Vijayji, Prabhuji gives the example of gold and other jewelries while explaining this context. So he says that the common this thing is the gold, that is the Brahman. The different forms might be the earring or the finger ring or the other necklace. So ultimately, when we meld it or whatever it is the gold part, what we get. The same way, the different, we are all in the different forms, might be flowers or human being or the animal or whatever. Ultimately, everything is the form of Brahman. Both are, it's the same. In that concept, topic 55 makes us clear.
Priyaji, there the question for us is, if Brahman is all, then why, where is this likes and dislikes coming from, right? Why do we don't like something?
That is the part of Maya, you're right. The Maya comes into existence. There we again, I don't know that comes in which part, the Rajo, Sattva, Rajas, Tamas, Gunas and all, Trigunatmakas will be stable. So with the action of Maya, they start moving and all, he explains. I don't know that comes in which part. So there only we start. Until that, like as a small child, it's the same. Like it does not have any blockages in the mind to learn this language or that language. So when somebody has to infer, again, that is the impact of Maya, right? So when I tell that, no, this is not the thing, you eat this, that or that. So there it comes, we start thinking. So what is the thinking? Again, something is activating, right? It is not in the part of inertia. There the movement starts, Rajoguna. Then only the liking and disliking it will come. But as such, the part of when we take the Brahma and we both are same, everything will be unique. It's the same. It will not be when we take into the individual part only, it makes us different. See, the thing is, the different forms will have different kinds of coverages. The Maya makes us the things, but whatever the inner this thing we have, it's all the same with the Brahman.
Very nice. Does that clarify Saranji's question?
I'm not completely still got the answer, because as I feel it is not due to Maya we are having the likes and dislikes. I still feel the likes and dislikes are to the subject, not due to the Maya outside. So maybe that discussion we should have.
So what Priyaji is essentially saying is, as a subject, you are pure. As pure awareness, see, in your talk, you clearly established there is pure awareness and there is easiness. What is world? World is nothing but easiness. Flower is, water is, tree is. So easiness in the awareness. So you're conscious of the easiness. So that is why Sat and Chit. So Sat and Chit is your true nature. Very clear. Now, what causes the, let's say, likes and dislikes? Like and dislike itself, any particular covering the body is a covering from the combination of the three gunas, the rajo guna, the tamo rajo and sattva guna. Any body, you will see these three qualities in different variations. So these three cause a certain activity, because for activity these three are necessary. Pure awareness, there is no movement because it is complete. You know, there is nothing to be achieved, there is nothing to be done. It is pure. There is no movement necessary. The movement is happening because of the three gunas. It is the three gunas that cause a change. Whenever a change happens, as a pure awareness, there is no judgment. As a pure awareness, there is no judgment. However, to that pure awareness, what is being taught by the society? This is very healthy for you. Take this. This is unhealthy. Don't take this. That is a good person. This is a bad person. So the pure awareness is non-judgmental. The child-like innocence is non-judgmental. The child is willing and ready to accept whatever the signal you give.
And it's a clean slate.
The society, what is society? Is Maya Shakti. And how is that Maya Shakti created? By the combination of the three gunas. And that in turn becomes the conditioning in the mind of the baby. That becomes a conditioning. Oh, I like this. I don't like this. Why? Because it has happened several times. You keep giving rice and rasam and say that rice and rasam is the only best thing in life. And that baby loves eating rice and rasam for breakfast, lunch, dinner. Same baby, you keep feeding bread and bun and say that this is the right breakfast, that loves bread and butter. And if bread and butter is not eaten, it feels incomplete. Conditioning. So conditioning is happening by the Maya Shakti. And that is the essence of what Priyaji was indicating. So the pure awareness is now conditioned by the content of the mind. Light is shining. If the water is muddy, the water appears muddy. The light is shining. If the water is black in color, the water appears black in color. Light is shining. If the water is pure, then it shows more. It seems to be spread. So the reflecting surface makes the light appear, oh, black light, oh, white light, oh, red light. No, nothing has happened to the light. The reflecting surface, the content of the mind. So that's why you are pure awareness. You are pure consciousness. So then what needs to be rectified? The rectification is only in the content of the mind. The content given by the society, not that everything is wrong, but the content given by the society, there is both. There is no Viveka that was given with the content given by the society. So now all that is being given is that Viveka. That, oh, okay. See, use this and separate what is truth and what is untruth. So with that, now that same awareness, when it functions through the same reflecting surface, can bring out its inherent qualities. No more needs to feel the raga dvesha. Raga dvesha may appear as a thought in the mind. It may appear. If the reflecting surface has a lot of mud, light will still hit and it will still appear. But now the judgmental faculty has now been tuned to ignore that and to focus on the right things. So it's only a correction that is happening in the faculty that is already there. Is this way of looking at what Priyaji said making sense?
Yeah. It is the mind which is the only place where tuning or correction is being done. Yeah.
And in the mind also, there's nothing wrong with the content of the mind. Content of the mind is the content of the mind. In that mind, there is a me and my thoughts is what makes it all limited. See, why is judgment happening in the first place? I like means I like. I as a body, I like mango. I as a body, I hate bitter gourd. So whenever the thinking is connected deeply with the body and the mind, me and the my thoughts, then only raga dvesha is appearing. Otherwise, whatever the content that is coming into the awareness, whatever the inputs that are coming to the awareness, need not cause any kind of disturbance. So that is the fundamental aspect of the Sakshi Bhava practice. Sakshi Bhava means what? As a witness to what? Witness to the movie that is happening in the mind. The impressions come. There is like and dislike arising within this mind also. Even that is being witnessed. There is no judgment towards, oh, I should be more holy. There is no judgment towards, oh, why am I unholy? There is no judgment for that also. That is a content of the reflecting surface. What to do? That's the nature of it. There's nothing right or wrong, want or don't want. So Sakshi Bhava is witnessing all the drama. Because the drama is happening here, we think that the drama is because of the impressions that are, the signals that are coming. The signals that are coming are hitting the reflecting surface and certain things are changing there. So the drama is because of all this magic. So this magic, the watching the magic is the maja of life.
Yeah, so the challenge has been the self not or the jiva not realizing the real nature and giving more importance or control to the objects outside and letting the objects control.
Yeah.
The jiva, right? Yeah. That's why the objects are able to hurt us or create good and bad things. While the learning is the other way. You the real awareness is superior to the objects. And the objects, you are giving life to them, and you give life to them. You decide how to take those objects. They are appearing in your awareness, right?
So the baby picks up the cat or the snake. In the baby, there is no hate. So that object responds likewise. World is a reflection of what I give to the world. Yeah, Padmaji.
Yeah, so I wanted to add
Your voice is not clear, Padmaji.
I wanted to add. Is it okay now?
Better now. Please raise it a little more towards.
Yeah. So I wanted to add something to this that I read somewhere. I can't remember where, but somewhere it said that if you feel that a few people don't love you, whether it is within your family or, you know, among wherever you are in your surroundings, if you feel that somebody doesn't love you or somebody doesn't respect you, you have such feelings, right, towards some people that, you know what, they don't respect me at all. So in those cases, it was written that if you feel that somebody doesn't respect you or somebody, this person doesn't love me or something like that, it says that give the same thing to yourself in excess. Like if you feel that somebody doesn't love you, you love yourself more. If you feel somebody doesn't respect you, you introspect whether you respect yourself enough. Because essentially what happens is when you feel somebody doesn't respect you, that means their actions are intimidating you or affecting you in a not very positive way. Right? So somewhere you are also allowing that to happen. Like without you letting something happen to you, can it really happen to you? It cannot. So somewhere you are letting it happen. So if you respect yourself more, you will definitely not let that happen. So it was essentially saying that what you feel about others is somewhere where you are feeling a lack within yourself. So when you look to, get rid of that lack, or you say that you're abundant in that particular thing, then automatically that animosity or whatever you're feeling towards that person reduces to a large extent. And when I go into this topic 55 and 56, it is even more evident that that thing is true, because ultimately it says that everything is, Brahman is dreaming. This is all a dream of Brahman. So it is saying that in the dream state, we only take different forms, right? We are this character, we are that character, we are this character. Then if we are everything, who do we have to fight with or have any animosity or any sort of feelings with, whether it is love or hate or anything? There is no one there. So it made more sense to me because when I read it first time, I thought, okay, this is some philosophical statement which somebody has written, but you don't know how to apply like all the other things in life. But when I went through this 55 and 56, it made more sense to me what I read before, that it is so true. Because when we like somebody also, there is a lot of bias in that, right? Sometimes we can't even see, even if they are truly being not good, you will still choose to ignore it. For example, with our own children or with our own spouses, we will choose to ignore it. But the same thing, we will not tolerate it if an outside person does it, okay? It will be a very truly a no thing for us. But okay, I love this person so much, so I'm willing to forgive and forget and move on. That is essentially the thing I feel. So again, like is also not so good. Earlier I used to think, okay, as long as I like everybody, those relationships are good. But no, I feel those are more detrimental, because it doesn't even show you the true picture. Whereas at least in that hate part, or wherever you don't like or you're not getting along well, you're constantly introspecting something. Either them, or eventually you start introspecting yourself also. Have I done something wrong here? Why is this like this? You start introspecting. But where you like somebody, it doesn't happen at all. It needs a third person, like a witness person, to come and point out that, okay, this is not right here. Maybe you're not seeing it, something like that. So that is where, I felt that 55, 56 and probably 57, which I have still not seen. I think that will give a better view of how to act in the world more well.
Padmaji, sometimes I always think, for example, in front of me, some 5 or 6 sweets are kept, okay? Kaju katli, Mysore pak, or XYZ, okay? So in front of you also, it's kept, okay? So I like some sweet and you like some sweet. So I think what is making me, no one has told me, like, Priya, you like only kaju katli. Till date, no one has told. So what is making me to like only that is, in my thought to judge that, which is provoking me to think like that. So such kind of, okay, if I think it's a part of Maya, or if I think that, even to tell Maya, so what is that? Or it is my essential nature to like only kaju katli. So even after going through like 55, 56, as you told, at least a few days, it makes us to be in confusion state. So everything like what is I'm doing? Is it my real true work? Or something is covering me to make that? And Vijayji told, right? Now it's the light part. Okay, something that mud is there, so we have to clear it. So is it really from my part, the my judgment is incorrect? So liking or disliking? So if so, the gunas what we have, that is rajo, sattva, tamo gunas. So which guna is more provoking me to do that? Or the trigunatmakas what we have inside? So it is from the previous birth, right? See, somebody like Western music. I like classical music. Why so? When again, it is from the previous this thing, the whatever the I have carried it, right? So almost like 2 or 3 days made me confusion, and finally I gave it up. I couldn't come into any of the conclusion. So it's again, it's from our part only. Decision and the judgment, whatever is giving, it's from our part only. So no one has told me.
Yeah,
Saravananji, Saravananji was telling like it is like paroksha, pramana, and for few things, yes, we will be having. And other things, no one would have referred. You like this or like that. We will be knowing that. Okay, the once it is the self-luminous, see, liking, for example, liking the particular sweet, no one has told us, you like that's this sweet only. Then why I am liking this sweet? No, so what is provoking me, provoking us to do like that? So such questions like, not in this
question. Let's stay with that question. So the yes. Your question, let's frame it clearly. The question is, what makes me like or dislike some things? Some things can be taught, but some things seem to be like inherent. Is this yes. Such an inherent quality like Sat and Chit and Ananda? That is your essential question.
Yes.
Very simple. Yeah, let's listen to what Padmaji wanted to say.
So yeah, so I feel that in things.
Your voice is breaking, Padmaji.
Padmaji, increase your volume.
No, my volume is increased.
She cannot increase the mic volume.
You speak now. Yeah. Please speak.
Yeah.
Now.
Yeah, you hold it near.
Yeah, is it
better? Is it
audible? Yeah. Yes, audible.
Yeah. So, what I was saying is essentially for things that you are saying that nobody has taught me, okay, and it seems to be inherent, I still feel that it is not inherent because there could be earlier vasanas within us. Is how I see it. Because, as far as sweet is concerned, we are labeling it as sweet and you have supposed a situation. For example, seeds, you have 5 sweets, whatever. So I might like bundi a lot. I might pick up the bundi first because that is something which is attracting me more, and you might pick up the kaju katli. This situation can arise in many things. For example, the kind of clothes we wear or the color of the clothes that we choose to wear, we can have preferences on it, but I don't, and those are not things that are being essentially taught to us. but we develop a certain liking towards it, or when somebody else wears it, we appreciate it more. Oh wow, see, this is my favorite color as well, something like that. But I still feel there is some conditioning to it. Maybe you are not aware of it because it is not coming from this lifetime, or maybe there are some previous vasanas. And also there are some things which comes as our prarabdha karma, which we cannot avoid. For example, like I have experienced some kind of animosity with one person with whom I have not interacted much only. Okay. There is no reason for that animosity. As soon as that person, interacted with me first time, you might not like that person at all. You know, you might not even look forward to it. Okay. You know, either you ignore or you keep thinking about that person. Oh my God. Okay. This kind of people also are there. Like that also you feel towards somebody. Whereas somebody, same kind of interaction, but you like them so much. From the first instinct, you like them so much. You might not even know them truly, but you like them so much. So anything that person does, you will like it. And similarly, even this other person with whom you are not so attuned to in frequency, they might not do something that is favorable only, but still you will not be able to see it because you have already have that, mind block in the mind about them. So they can never be right for you. And there is no need for that is what I feel, because ultimately it's only about us, how we react, how we interact with anything outside us. It is essentially only that, how we interact or react with others or act with others. It has got nothing to do with outside. It is only that some of our own actions, I think inherently we know that this is not the way to act. That is when we try to pin it on that other person, because it is not easy. It is not easy to pin it on ourselves that, you know, we are doing wrong or we are, our thoughts are like this. It's not easy. So we will find something outside of us, thinking it is outside of us, that, okay, because of this person, I behave like that. Or because she did that or he did that, I am behaving like that. And the same might be from that point of view. We don't know that. So that is when it gets mutual, I feel. But for things like what you are saying is, I feel there are some earlier vasanas that we carry. We have no way of knowing that, I feel.
I think we should explore more into that. And we should keep...
Vijay sir, if you want to...
I would like to keep...
Everyone's views.
I would like to keep these two actually different, the eating part and the people part. Because the people part, it is... There is a two-way thing. In the eating part, there is only one way. So I want to have a separate discussion on the eating, then move to the people. Yeah, we'll wait for Shubhaji.
Shubhaji, what is your view?
So there is one sentence which really impressed me in the T55, which I have noted down by Prabhuji. He says, appearance is not real, but existence behind appearance is reality. And existence, I can't know without awareness. So ultimately, it comes to awareness part. This particular line really just made me think about what exactly when we look at life. So it's ultimately the awareness, which is subjective and not direct experience for me. So only the direct experience is what we have to consider. All other things are really subjective, is what Prabhuji was pointing in T55. So I would say it's the consciousness is an experience in itself, which I have to go through.
Yeah, so how do you connect that to what Priyaji's question? Priyaji's question is, I have so many sweets in front of me. Nobody told me what to pick up, but I picked up something saying that this is what I like. What it triggered, what prompted me to think in that way? That is her question.
Yeah, that I feel it is more based on our experience. Rather, it is, it's our experience is what I feel. like we have bias towards one things and
yes, our question is what caused that bias? It is clear that, you know, I like kaju barfi. Oh, I like kaju barfi. That's what they keep saying. But what is that that caused that?
I feel it is more towards conditioning side, sir.
So you also agree with what Padmaji is saying? It is conditioning of the mind.
No. No, we are not conditioning. You are not conditioning your kids to have something, some sweet, right? They themselves, they seem to have some inherent liking. Somebody, like you are not telling, I have tried to, I like some things and I find it very, very odd that my kids don't like it. And I cannot even accept it that like someone in the world cannot like it. Okay, so... right, so there is no conditioning there.
Now what is happening, you know, everything now these days I'm coming to a conclusion that everything is my vasanas. So previous this, so whatever I do, everyone know, other the surrounding people is not at all liking. If I want to do this, the other one, simple is, if I tell my son to read English, he tells I'll do current affairs from the internet. So simple things is also not working out. So likes and dislikes are working like this.
It is correct what Padmaji is saying. You are pure. You have no raga and dvesha. But raga and dvesha is a property because of the connection or disconnection to the content of the mind. So let's understand this little clearly.
Notice. So sometimes we are ready to accept it also, right? Acceptance is also there. I'll come to that.
See, a little baby. Little baby, first of all, for the sake of simple understanding, I'll give you one personal example. My elder son, used to be breastfed. And it was almost like 1.5 years or so. He was not willing to give up. So one little experiment my wife did was, she put some this neem oil when she breastfed him. First time, you know, his face, we still have that video and we enjoy seeing that video. So all that one time, again he went. And from that day, he stopped. So till then, there was no conditioning about whatever he was consuming. That day, there was a conditioning that, oh, this is bitter. Likewise, now he may not recall why it is so. But like Padmaji said, no, lack of access to the memory doesn't mean that it was not conditioned. It is conditioned. When it got conditioned, you may not be aware. For example, how we get conditioned to buy certain things. Just notice, advertisement is all about awareness about your subconscious mind. It is said that in advertisement industry, for something to be registered in your mind, you have to see it at least about 7 times in different places. So that's why big companies want to be in front of you somehow. In video, in television, in audio, hoarding. And then you start recognizing. Please notice, little children say, I want to eat McDonald's. How did that come into them? You have never told them. I love burgers. They talk about all this. How? There is a marketing that can be done in a way that, you know, you hear the same thing 6 or 7 times. Please, first of all, see, there is no judgment in you in the first place. There is no right or wrong in you in the first place. It is like the space. This space can accept whatever form that comes into this space. Space has no judgment. Bholenath. Shiva is said to be Bholenath. So that is your inherent nature, non-judgmental. So this comes. Now when this comes, you know, 6 or 7 times, then the depending upon the surface, there is a bias that is getting created. Oh, it is tasting different. Even that taste, that little child, you know, the taste of the breast milk was okay. Now something else came. It is not a like or dislike yet. It is something else. The face got contorted. But then there is something about, oh, this is what was nice because it has been conditioned for such a long time. See, for almost 1.5 years, oh, now it is weird. No. So the mind is not open enough to experiment. But the conditioning happened. No, that time conditioning happened. Some input from the society came and that conditioned that the mind. Similar thing happens with respect to people also. So when Saravanti said, you know, people and sweet are different, in a way they're fundamentally not different. Please notice how we condition little children. The baby is very nice. Baby is playing with everybody. Somebody comes and says, hello, Chinno, who do you like the most? Appa, Amma. Now the baby doesn't have a feeling of liking or disliking, but they want to prompt. Who do you like? Appa or Amma? Or in some cases, sometimes not to make the baby do some things, they use somebody else. Eat now, otherwise I'll call your Appa. He will come. So now the baby has no tension about the Appa, but now you eat, otherwise Appa will come. Oh my God, Appa will do something. Appa is now, oh, I have to be afraid of the Appa. So you see, conditioning. The unconditioned is getting conditioned. This, when it is repeated, it starts becoming deeper impressions. What is samskara? The word samskara is what you do repetitively becomes a deeply held impression in your mind, that it becomes the vasana. And that vasana, when it is making you do things in the world, it becomes your tendency or your vritti. So a butcher becomes a butcher because he has seen somebody else do it, and it has become repetitive in his mind. So it is like the Bhramara Kita Nyaya. Remember, I've told you this story. So the Bhramara brings this Kita, and the Kita is so afraid of the Bhramara's sting that eventually it becomes a Bhramara. Like what Swami Vivekananda said, you become what you think. You are the creator of your destiny. The deeply held conditioning in the mind is that, oh, I see, the world is full of thieves, because that is the conditioning that has gone into me. Oh, the world is full of liars. That is the conditioning that has gone into me. Oh, the world is full of idiots. That is the conditioning that has gone into me. The world is lovely. That's also, in a way, conditioning. But that is when you help the other one realize the inherent nature. It is not that, you know, I'm passing a judgment. Hey, love kaju barfi. Why are you not liking everything? You have to like everything. Love kaju barfi, love masala dosa, love. That is again another kind of conditioning, forcing you to love. Love my holy book. My holy book is the only book. Love my holy book. Otherwise, I'm going to cut your head. That is a forced conditioning to like something. No. The realization that your true nature is non-judgmental. You learn the art of judgment through the life's experiences. So the same sweet you love the most, just please go back. In your own life, you must have been liking something, but now you feel, I don't, you know, no more, it is so exciting for me. Maybe as a little child, chocolate was super. Now the same 5 paisa chocolate is not so super. One time, you know, maybe one hero used to make you feel, whoa, now, ayo. So these things, which means what? It is changing. So what is changing cannot be real. So like and dislike is a function of your own experience and outlook of life. Your heart used to miss a beat before you got married. Then, ayo, let it, why? So again, change in conditioning. So conditioning, anything that is, you know, you like, you can definitely dislike one day. Where there is raga, there is dvesha just behind it. So therefore, that is unreal. Because what comes in a package as raga and dvesha is unreal. It is definitely because of the conditioning. When it got conditioned into your mind, you may not be aware. That's why it is said that, you know, what you give to the little children when they're young is very important. Very, very important, because that becomes a tree and it sprouts. Why? Because as a little child, there is no judgment. You can make the child hate the world, hate certain kind of people, hate certain things, because the little baby has no judgment. So what we put into the mind of the child when they're young, extremely important, very, very important. We can make or break that life. They don't know why they hate the world so much. I hate those people. Those people are cause of all my suffering. You know, my ancestors suffered because of these people. You know, my own community is suffering because of those people. It can happen in so many ways. It is not just about two religions, two languages. I had firsthand seen one person say, I hate Kannadigas. They think Kaveri is their property. They killed so many Tamilians. I hate Kannadigas. So all this very strong likes and dislikes, they all come from the conditioning. It may be in different flavors. See, that raga and dvesha, it expresses itself in different flavors, but fundamentally it is caused by the conditioning that has gone into the mind. So to realize that all this is conditioning, all this is because of the play of the world, all this is maya, is the only way to really find the freedom. So when Priyaji said, is it my vasana? Absolutely correct. On the spot. My life is nothing but play of the vasanas in my mind. But my life need not have to be by the limitation of the vasana. Now that I have this jnana, I can be liberated from the tendency of the vasana. I am not a butcher. Valmiki was Ratnakara, who was a murderer. If he had held on to the conditioning that I'm a murderer, then life wouldn't have seen Ramayana. The very fact that Ratnakara found the liberation, where in his heart he realized his true nature and he said, that is in the past, let it be so. Now what can I do? Angulimala was conditioned to be Angulimala. And Buddha's jnana liberated him. So it is said that after Angulimala became Buddha's Shishya, he would go for begging. And he would get hit by stones and sticks and abuses. Every time he would come back crying, bleeding. And the love of Buddha was the balm. Compassion is not a learned behavior. It's not a condition of the society. Compassion is your true nature. Please go back to the video that you saw again. That little child, how can you teach compassion? So recognize what is natural and what is taught. Satya, asatya. Nitya, anitya. That is the only true way, the true power of this jnana, to then come to the clarity of, okay, why, what is happening around me? So if all the things that are happening around me are due to my tendencies in the mind, then the only correction needed is in my own tendencies of life. When someone is not loving to me, it means that I have to offer more love and care. When someone is ignoring me, I have to learn to accept them more. So the only place I can correct is within me. Is this bringing clarity to Priyaji's question?
To some extent, yes, Vijayji. Still, what is
the question that is still left?
Still, I work on that vasanas part only.
So what is the question?
See,
ask the question.
Yes, you have clarified many things, like yes, the corrections or whatever. See, first time, for example, what Padmaji was telling, dress when I take up or this thing. As soon as I see, I like only cotton dress. So no one has told me before to like, or it is not the conditioning.
You never know
also.
How it has come into you, no?
Yeah, correct. It is not the conditioning also. So whenever I am born, whenever I am born, no one has told me that you have to like
cotton
dress
only. That is
because
you are thinking that, you know, you are conditioned only by the current impressions. That is why, you know, you bring with you samskara as a subtle body. Samskara is what you carry from life to life.
So that is what I'm telling. Might be it is. Now I am started thinking everything is my samskaras and vasanas.
Everything is an impression. When that impression came, you don't know. Like Padmaji said, you know, you see somebody, you have an instant liking. You see somebody, you have an instant hate. How is that possible? Because of all these impressions. Look at another way. A small baby who is not... especially during Annaprashana, the small baby has no awareness of that taste. And for the first time, it doesn't necessarily go and say, oh, wow, I love it and give me more. You know, it is not smiling. Usually the child throws it out because the only thing that is conditioned to the baby is the mother's milk. Every other taste is a condition. It is born in a family which eats only vegetarian and very sattvic food, it starts liking that. It's born in a family which eats all kinds of food and lots of masala, chili. Then it says that, ayo, what is this food? Very bland. Put more chili. But the same mind can still be conditioned to go back. But it takes time.
Correct. It takes time. It's only by experience, like how Satyaji told.
It's a practice.
It's a practice and experience makes us to think what is right and what is wrong and what makes me to adapt to that situation.
Correct.
Everything is understood. Again, like now after these videos, only these things are happening.
Because all the impressions from the previous life, how can you, you're not aware. Doesn't mean that they are not there. You're not aware in the sense of consciously, you're not able to see when it came into you. See, if you go to a field and you put a seed and you see that sprouting, you know, oh, I put the seed and it came. But when the seed came into that field, if you are not able to recall, it makes you wonder, oh, it seems like a magic. But how can there be? That seed must have come sometime.
I want to share one thing here.
Mike.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah, so I wanted to share one thing, sir. Like last year, I and my husband went to a program where we did something on teenage children. Okay, so the first thing that we did in understanding our teenager was the person told us, please note down three positive things that you think about yourself and three negative things that you think about yourself. It could be anything. So in that, you know, I had written fear of water because I tried to learn swimming and it was not successful. So that was something which I was not able to overcome. So one of the things was that. And then my husband had a set of things and positives and negatives. And then the next exercise was, now you write three positives and negatives about your child below that. Okay. And then because it was a husband-wife program, obviously I had written different positive and negative for my son. And my husband had written different, whatever his understanding was, positive and negative about my son. But ultimately, then he said that now you bring both the things together. And now you see your child's positive and negative will also reflect in either your husband's positive and negative or your positive and negative. And that was so true, because somewhere, even if we don't say it outright, we are manifesting it. Like I remember, I used to take Adi to swimming lessons, and because I couldn't learn. So I thought that, you know, that fear should not come in him. Okay. So I started at 3 years, I took him. All his friends would go and we would sit there, and it was in Singapore. So a lot of safety and all those things were there. So we will just sit there and watch. Okay, I will have no peace sitting there, because probably looking him in the water, I am going through that same experiences in my mind about how I feel. Okay, so that child didn't learn swimming. He would go lap after lap, I have seen, but he will be exhausted, but he couldn't learn swimming. So somewhere, you know, I feel, and eventually, see, he was someone who will enjoy water. He, even today, he enjoys water. But if you tell him that, you know what, you enjoy water so much, can we get an instructor for you? Immediately, no, I don't have to learn swimming. And because he's grown up now so much, he will say that, oh, just because I know swimming, it doesn't mean that if I fall in the ocean, I can save myself. That is another, you know, it's not possible like that. But initially, we have tried it so many times. So I feel that somewhere I have translated it to him. I don't know. I have not gone and told him, because my first thing for him to learn swimming itself was that he should not be afraid like me. But then it ended up being like that, because somewhere in my mind, I am constantly sitting there and thinking, oh my God, will he also feel what I was feeling in water? And we have a deeper connection. So maybe, you know, I don't even have to say it out. It just translates somehow to him.
Yeah.
Is what I feel. So many times we don't, I think, have to necessarily say it, or we don't have to remember the conditioning, like how it was not told to us. But we would have observed, for example, I love kaju katli. So most of the time I will get that only. So obviously my child, even without any conditioning, has been used to eating kaju katli.
Because the samskara you are building now.
Two times, correct. At that time, I'm not essentially thinking it is positive, negative. I'm just buying what I like. That's all. And but because he is used to it, tomorrow if he sees five sweets, the first sweet he will go for is the kaju katli, because he's used to it. He know how it tastes. So the experimenting is only later.
There was a wonderful question by somebody who was asking, I'm walking from, he's in a college, in a department. Whenever I'm going towards my department, I always see somebody. And when I'm going out of the department, I always tend to see the same body, the same person many a times. It is like, first of all, you're used to certain faces. Even among a crowd, your mind can immediately recognize your child or your known ones. How? Because of repetitive remembrance. Today, when you hear Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, it brings a certain immediate connection to that, because it's now is becoming a samskara. Our satsanga is a samskara. So from when it started, that you may not remember. But in past life, there's a past life regression technique where, you know, they can take you back into your memory bank. Your memory bank is infinite. Your memory bank is infinite, and it is not erased at all. It is there of lifetimes and lifetimes of memory. Everything is stored in the memory bank. What appears, that's why it is said, sadhana is all about, there's a conscious mind, there's an unconscious, subconscious mind. Your deeply held beliefs and fears and unknowns are all in the subconscious part of the mind, which is like 80-90%. And subconscious mind is not even in your waking hours, in your awareness. That is what brings up various vasanas. It is deeply held. Some memory from some past, need not to be another life. As a child, let's say as a child, you are constantly told, don't speak in front of elders. You don't know, idiot. Then you constantly keep thinking, I'm an idiot. Oh, I don't know. Oh, maybe I don't know. So you're very afraid of even opening up. Oh, you know, if I say this, you know, will somebody judge me as an idiot? So you don't know how it happened. Then you'll start saying, oh, you know, I don't like talking to people. I sound stupid. How? Because somewhere, who did it? That is not the point. Why they did it? That is not the point. The point is, my current behavior, my current tendencies are from the impressions. So becoming free from the impressions of the mind is the true freedom. The liberation, what we talk about is that you are not influenced by the content of your mind, but by the nature of the current situation. Priyaji, hope enough pointers have been given.
Yes, Vijayji.
If there is still, then like we should do it next session,
yes,
again.
Yes, we'll continue.
Then but yeah, so ordering is Swiggy. Otherwise, today the coffee also, no, I have to cook it.
Okay.
Yeah. So the question, the understanding for me is like, now we know that the likes and dislikes today are coming from many, many lives of the samskaras. What next? How do you uncondition yourself? What is the most effective way to get out of this trap?
Yeah.
Both the like trap and the dislike trap. Because that's what is like actually...
Then only it makes us free from everything.
Exactly.
So we can enjoy whatever that moment, that performance, that moment we can enjoy. So as we learn more and more, we start connecting the dots here and there. So rather than clarification, sometimes makes me confusion. Sorry.
No, confusion. Confusion is good.
Correct.
Which means that, you know, some rectification can be brought. So there's nothing to be worried about the confusion. If you did not have confusion, we wouldn't have 45 minutes of conversation.
Correct. Why it happened is, last week when I was in Mysore, my mother itself said, why you are different from us? In every aspect, you are different from why you are so different from us? So then the whole 7 hours, 8 hours, I started thinking from my childhood journey, like why is she telling her column? Sorry. So why it is different? Why what making them that I am different? And again, I'm thinking why my kids are also telling why Amma, you are different. So whatever if I tell that they don't like. So why it is happening, or might be the effect of this 50, 55 or 56, or I have changed it, or the situation like that. It's like 15 days it was making me.
So the only freedom is, you know, that you are none of that. You are none of the content of your mind. So the true liberation is that you are not the mind. I am not the body is relatively easier to realize. I am not even the content of the mind is where a lot of subtle connections are there. You are not the mind in the sense that content of the mind. You are not the impressions. So go back to that.
And you are not.
From there you work, then it becomes clearer.
Yes.
And you are not what others think as well.
And even what you think.
What you think.
Yes.
That depends on like with what glasses you are seeing yourself. Is it with Vedanta's view you are seeing yourself, or the world view?
Because fundamentally, like you said, what others think is an object in the mind. So ultimately it's only who I am thinking. So the thinker in me is the one who says, this is how I am. This is how others are thinking about me. Others may or may not have said it. I am the one who is passing all the judgment all the time. There's only I who is talking to me and making the whole drama continue.
And I think the bigger problem is trying to fight this saying, everyone else should understand me. Then, right? You cannot condition the objects outside, right? It's like they will change. They will keep changing, right? Today they may not understand, tomorrow they will understand. Today they may understand, tomorrow they will not understand. But you know yourself, I know myself, what it is.
That is why the training, the objects are changing. Okay, you got the jnana of tatva bodha, but has it become a living reality? Till then, the confusion will continue to come, and it's a good thing that the confusion is coming. It is like only when the exam is written, you know, okay, how it is happening. So, nothing to be afraid of it. May all the exams come. Shall we end our today's session?
Yes, we did.
Yeah.
Saravananji?
Yeah. Light seeking. Om Asato Ma Sadgamaya Tamaso Ma Jyotirgamaya Mrityorma Amritam Gamaya. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Om, lead me from untruth to truth, darkness to light, impermanence to permanence.
This should be our every moment's prayer. In every moment, there is truth and untruth. So separating that is why the Hamsa is given as the symbol of wisdom. Hamsa. The Hamsa is the one which can separate the milk from the water. Every moment there is Maya and there is unchanging. To separate that is the whole journey.
Self is the whole. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamataya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Om, that is complete. This is complete. When completeness is removed from completeness, what remains is complete. When completeness is added to completeness, totality remains complete. Om, peace, peace, peace. Who am I? Nanu, nanenbadu, nanalla, ideha manabuddhi, nanalla, sachidanandatma, shivananu nani, shivoham, shivoham, shivoham. I'm not the body, mind, intellect. I'm pure consciousness, Shiva Swarupi. I'm true self, is liberation. Atma darshanam, Brahma darshanam, Brahma darshanam, Satya darshanam. Recognition of self is recognition of the whole. Recognition of the whole is the truth. May all be free from suffering. Om Triambakam Yajamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam Purvarkamiva Bandhanat Mrityor Mukshiyam Amritat. Om Triambakam Yajamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam Purvarkamiva Bandhanat Mrityor Mukshiyam Amritat. Om Triambakam Yajamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam Purvarkamiva Bandhanat Mrityor Mukshiyam Amritat. We worship the three-eyed one who is fragrant and who nourishes all. Like the fruit falls off from the bondage of the stem, may we be liberated from death, from mortality. Lokaha smastaha sukino bhavantu. Lokaha smastaha sukino bhavantu. Lokaha smastaha sukino bhavantu. May all beings be happy, healthy, and peaceful. Hari Om.
Hari Om.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Sunday.
See you. See you next week.
Hari Om. Hari Om. Hari Om.